Almost 14,000 bear sightings have been reported in Japan so far this year.
Bears, wild boars and deer are roaming around everywhere.
But now the risk of human casualty was becoming high.
Hunters shot and killed a bear early this morning.
Is the bear problem in Japan really at such a crisis point? The Japanese black bear, a subspecies of the Asiatic black bear, which is classified as vulnerable by the IUCN, currently divides opinion in Japan. In not so distant history, the bear was revered as an important cultural symbol associated with the gods, mountains, and mountain spirits. They were referred to as Yamautoku or Sabishigaria, given their often humanoid appearance. But the bear has fallen out of favour in recent times, and the lonely man in the mountain is becoming increasingly isolated and bereft of allies. A declining rural human population and poor availability of natural food sources has brought about increasing human-bear conflict. But the situation is salvageable, and it's certainly manageable. Like any relationship, it takes work to maintain. It may not be possible to go to couples therapy, but we can certainly work on our issues. To do this, we have to answer the question, how do we work away from conflict and towards coexistence? I've spent 3 months working alongside Picchio Wildlife Research Centre to find this out. Picchio are at the forefront of Japanese black bear conservation and responsible for the day-to-day bear management of the wider Karizawa town area. Although only a relatively small team with limited resources, the work that they do is recognised as pioneering. Picchio's approach starts with us. The first step in their management strategy is to install preventative countermeasures, installing electric fences around apiaries, bush cutting when forests grow too dense and close to human habitation, and successfully dealing with the waste problem in Karizawa. Bears would be seen regularly raiding the easily accessible and plentiful human waste, but a 20-year campaign to install specially designed bear-proof bins has kept waste out of reach. However, as a Yosemite Park ranger was famously quoted as saying, there is considerable overlap between the intelligence of the smartest bears and the dumbest tourists. All it really takes is one individual to not buy in or use equipment properly, and we're back to square one. This takes us to the next step of Picchio's strategy, education and training. Picchio experts regularly provide educational talks and experiences for local children, instilling respect for their mountain neighbours that will last a lifetime. The children learn how to reduce their impacts on the bears, the ecosystem services the bears provide, and what to do should they ever meet one. This reduces the likelihood and severity of conflict, both now and in the future. But the main job of Picchio is the active management of the bear population. A capture-release program is the foundation of this, with strategically placed barrel traps around the town perimeter, capturing bears wandering where they shouldn't. Bears are then anaesthetised and processed, noting specific measurements, injuries, behavioural traits, unique markings, and samples taken to be sent to various research projects. Keeping detailed records of the local bear population is crucial in guiding decision making for wildlife managers. Bears are then fitted with radio collars projecting signals that allow them to be tracked via radio telemetry. Every night when the bears are active, Picchio search for signals and identify any bears too close for comfort or moving to an undesirable location. Locations are then passed on to the chasing team, who individually target bears to chase away from town. Their partners for this? Karelian bear dogs, a Finnish dog traditionally bred for hunting large game. The dogs and their handlers make loud, threatening displays and sometimes provide a physical stimulus to encourage bears to move to a more favourable location. This prevents conflict before it happens. Aversive conditioning is part of bear releases too. In order to drive home the association of humans with fear and being something to avoid, similar techniques are employed as bears are released. Their last memory of humans will be fireworks, catapults, shouting, bear bells and bear dogs, leaving a lasting negative impression of humans as well as the behaviour that led them to be captured in the first place. This is just a short summary of Picchio's approach to bear management, but it's clear to see how all-encompassing it really is. By using a mixture of tried and tested techniques and novel approaches, they're steadily improving the lives of all of Karizawa's residents, bear and human alike. But they can't do it all alone. You can help too. You can advocate and educate, engage with others and help to explain why human-bear conflict arises and how we can prevent it. You can take action. If you're currently living alongside bears in Japan or elsewhere, look at what you can be doing differently. Is your waste stored correctly? Do you wear a bear belt to alert bears to your presence? Or you can work with Picchio directly. Picchio run international internship programs for those who want to get involved. Whether you want to work as a nature guide and educate the next generation on Japanese flora and fauna, or work as a hands-on member of the bear team, there is something for everyone. Simply head to the Picchio website to submit an application or contact them directly. But back to the original question, is the bear problem in Japan at a crisis point? I really don't think so. And what's more, Picchio have demonstrated how coexistence with our mountain neighbour is a distinctly achievable goal. We just have to keep working towards it.